Hello everyone, welcome to another video of Flight Simulator 2020. In today's video, I'd like to show you how to perform a VOR. You've probably heard of this one before in a previous video on how to do a VOR approach, but this time we actually have two other VORs which go by the names of VOR A and VOR B. It's the same concept like any typical VOR, but the only reason why there's A or B, Alpha or Bravo, is that for VOR A, when you're doing approach with the final approach course of more than 3 degrees offset from the runway heading, it just tells you distinctly that you're within the range of possibly a straight in or circling minimums. However, for VOR Bravo or VOR B, the airport does have a straight in minimum, and that they'll require you to do a circling approach to the intended runway. Now, for today's flight, I chose Jekyll Island 09er Juliet, somewhat favorite airport that I like. I'm not doing my instrument practices. The only reason why I say it's my favorite, not just because it's VOR A approach, but when you are exactly across from the VOR or Vortec, you have to make a direct turn and descend immediately towards minimum. If you do not do so, you would actually miss your chance to have the airport sighting. You have to do a missed approach procedure from there. So it's very time crucial, especially for this airport. So right now, I'll take you guys along the way to show you how to prepare for that. So the approach course for the Vortec is the SSI 109.8. I already put the approach course 037. The runway length is not applicable because it's well, it should give you a straight in, but for this specific airport it has no straight in minimum or approach, so we're gonna have to circle for that one. And then the touch nose elevation is not applicable. Airport elevation is 12, well, of course 12. And of course you have your little notes, so use St. Simon's altimeter setting. When I receive, use Jacksonville National Timber Standing and increase the minimum decision altitude of 100 feet. And that's just a little side note if you ever come to that situation. And then of course you have the best approach. You have climbing, make the climb, right turn to 2000, directed to Vortec SSI and hold. And if you're still not below if you're still below 2000, continue to climb and hold until you reach that 2000 altitude. You have your frequencies. If you have your frequencies, the SSI ASOS, that's the weather station. When you're trying to approach the airport, you have Jacksonville Center, and of course, people that take you to another airport, guide you to your intended destination. And then, last but not least, you have a UNICOM or a CTAF, Common Traffic Advisory Frequency 123.05. That will be using when we're around the vicinity of the airport, like around 10 miles. Just to let traffic know that we're closing in the airport and what's our current position and what's our intention, of course, so that it gives them an idea to be aware. So your published minimum is 1000, which is the final approach fix. That's the minimum you can be at until you cross over that fix, and then from there you can descend down to the circling minimums of 480 feet, and then from there you either have the airport site, or if not, you discontinue the landing and do your missed approach procedure. And of course, this is your MDA, which means minimum decision altitude. This is a non-precision approach. So as it is, I'm going to start descent. Just wait for the VOR to come live. But I'll just, instead, if there is no traffic whatsoever at Jekyll Island, I'll probably might take runway 1A. Because that's a better chance, because I'll just have to fly over the airport and make a left traffic, just basically a VFR left traffic from there, and then that'll make it more easier for me instead of just having to make a tight turn directly to left base for runway 36. There's a possible chance you might not make it, so it's always better to make it more easier for you. So that's why I'm gonna take 1-8 if there's no traffic around the airport, mind you. Thank you. So it's always good to use two OBSs for redundancy, because it's if one OBS fails, you can always use your backup, which is either one or two. So as you can see, I've put in like 037 in top words, and for the OBS number two, I just put in like around 09 or zero. Correction, yeah, 009. Because I'm already centered, that would lead me to the VOR, and once I'm at the Vortec, now I can start my descent down to minimum 480. At the same time, heading at 037, so I can be established on the descent approach towards the airport, and around 480 I should be able to have the airport in sight. If not, I'll just do the missed approach, like we discussed earlier. So right now we're like 1,000 feet, that's our minimum, published minimum that we should be at. We can't go lower until we cross over the final approach fix or the Vortec itself. So as I'm continuing on heading at 009er, 010 pretty much, I should be able to lead my way towards the Vortec based on my current position. And if you haven't seen the other video, you're going to notice that the deal on the OBS number 2 is on the left. The only way to correct it is just apply 10 degrees left, which would be like right around 360, possibly 350, just for the needle to center itself, as you can see right now. And once the needle's in the center, you can zoom back to your heading of 009er directly towards the Vortec. I like flying the rain, especially in the sim, because it just adds more realism, like you would actually do in the actual aircraft and in an actual IFR flight. It makes the pilot multitask, make sure they're on focus and on point, not distracted by spatial disorientation and such. Because that's the basics of having an instrument rating, is that you are able to fly in meteorological conditions. So I guess I have slight visual on landmarks right now, but that just doesn't really give anything. But here it is. Okay, as you can notice that the needle OBS number 1 just became active. Now I can start my descent, pull power, slight idle, carb heat on, flaps 1 so I can descend faster. And we'll just make sure it'll be a more appropriate descent, like 500, nothing more than 1000. Okay, so 037. I put in 050 so I can reestablish on the needle. So right now I'm at 0.037, which makes a center. And somehow there we go, we have the runway in sight. That's Jekyll Island, exactly north of us. Or on our 12 o'clock, excuse me. And since there's no traffic whatsoever making an announcement around the airport vicinity, I'll just possibly just make the runway 1A instead in relation to 36, which makes it easier for me. So right now, I'm going to fly over the airport. Probably make my comms with communication, you know, give other aircrafts an idea where I am. So I'm overflying the airplane, the airport. I'm overflying the airport. I'll make a left downwind towards 21.8. The minimum is 480, so that's our circling altitude right now. And once I'm a beam of the air, the threshold for runway 1A, I'm gonna start my descent from there. So that's it, that's the threshold of the beam. So we're starting to descend from there. Make the turn to the base. And also keep in mind, it's always important to have visual reference, or a visual eye on the runway, so it doesn't come out of sight. If you don't keep an eye on the runway, you lose focus completely, and then you have to pretty much a band landing from there. So now I'm on final. Just pull power out, let the aircraft slow down, airspeed bleed off. And then just nicely touch it down. And then there you are, that's how you, there you go, that's how you do a VR alpha approach. I'm just gonna take this taxiway. So hopefully you found this very helpful and informative. I'll upload a video on how to do a VR Bravo approach this time. So if you like what you see, then consider liking. If you're not a current subscriber, then please consider subscribing for more future videos. And I'll be seeing you guys in the next video.